Johnson, member of the Budget Committee, joins us now with his outlook. There will be like fireworks and celebrations if you guys just do anything. I know that probably doesn't make you happy because it doesn't address any of our long-term issues, but are we wrong to celebrate a small deal?
Let's face it, the last thing anybody wants is a shutdown, other than maybe Harry Reid and President Obama to distract from the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act. I'm that right winger that is saying we need to use that full name. But no, the federal government does enough harm to our economy. Just day in and day out, the last thing we need is to heap on additional harm by shutting down the government. So, yeah, I know Republicans are absolutely dedicated to fixing the long-term problem, but we certainly don't want a shutdown at all. So I know Paul Ryan, I think Chairman Murray are really working together to try and just stabilize the situation, come up with something. If we can get some long-term mandatory reforms in exchange for, some sequester relief, maybe plus up some defense. I know people are highly concerned about readiness in our military, and you got to do a little giving from that standpoint. But you need some real structural reform to the long-term mandatory spending programs in order for that deal to work.
It puts it out past the 2014 election.
That's what they're talking again. And let's hope nobody throws a poison pill in there.
Well, at this point, you're from Wisconsin. I see Wisconsin as at best a middle of the road state. I think you kind of lean left.
I would call it a common sense state. I mean, we're really a bunch of folks that think the government ought to live within its means.
Really?
I think so. Yeah.
But you do. I think of it as kind of a. I mean, isn't Madison, Wisconsin? Isn't University of Wisconsin there?
It has its pockets of
just like Boulder.
Interesting individuals. Sure.
Okay, but from what you can tell, from what you're hearing, how's 14 going to go? I mean, at this point, if Obamacare continues to go along the path it's going, what will 2014 look like? What will the makeup look like in the House? What will it look like in the Senate?
Well, again, because of the disaster of the implementation of the health care law, I think 2014 actually does look pretty optimistic.
You predicting be in a majority?
I'm predicting nothing. But I think for the first time Americans, the problem with trying to repeal Obamacare to fund it beforehand was that it was just theoretical, and people would look at, I knew for, forever that millions of Americans were going to lose their health care, and there would be millions more. But it was just theory. Once it actually started being implemented, now Americans actually are feeling the real disaster that the health care law is, where we've got millions of Americans losing the health care, losing access to the doctors and treatments that are keeping them alive. And we're going to continue to hear these real individuals, these victims of the health care law, and that's going to have definitely a negative impact on, I think, Democrats trying to run for Senate. I mean, let's face it, anybody that voted for that bill, anybody that mouthed those same words, if you like your health care plan, you can keep it in there. Plenty Senate Democrats, plenty House Democrats that told that exact same untruth, let's put it that way.
Senator, assuming that that the Affordable Care Act does create some difficulties for Democrats, particularly those seeking office, what should the Republican Party do to kind of advance its own cause between now and the 2014 elections?
Well, I heard you earlier. It's difficult to repeal Obamacare. It's no longer just a piece of paper that you can repeal and make it go away.
Right.
It's been implemented. It's structurally in place.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the responsible thing to do is, what can we do to limit the damage? That's why I introduced the bill. If you like your health plan, you can keep it active. Now, you can't do a whole lot for these individuals that have already been canceled, but you can do an awful lot to make sure that individuals that get group policies, get mm-hmm. their insurance through their employer, that those health care plans can be preserved by reducing or eliminating the coverage mandates that are driving up the cost of health care. You know, in Wisconsin, if you're a 27-year-old male, on average, your insurance premium will increase by 124%, go from by $1,100 to $2,400.
Wait, what do you mean reducing some?
What I would do is, I heard Dr. Emanuel on Sunday shows yesterday, and he's saying this is about choice. No, it's not. It's about coercion. So let's actually preserve freedom and choice in health care. So let's, keep the Obamacare health plans in place. Give those as an option for individuals. But we should also give individuals the freedom to choose a plan that doesn't have the mandated coverages, because that is what is driving up the cost.
It doesn't work.
It's not going to work anyway.
But if you want to set this up as an insurance pool, which basically means everybody is in the pool and you're paying insurance, and even if you're a man and you don't want to have maternity coverage, you got to pay for it too, so it's more affordable for the women who are of maternity age. I mean, that's the way it all works out. And just from a math perspective, I'm not arguing whether this should have been done or not,
but
that's the only way it works.
But it's not working out. It's not working out.
But,
you know, remember, President Obama said he was going
to
bend the cost curve down.
Anyway.
Does anybody believe the cost curve has been bent down? I mean, look at all the promises made.
I'm not picking up the flag and running and waving
right.
with this, but if you have Peter Orszag or somebody else who comes in, they would say, yes, you have seen a bend. Other people will say, no, it's because of the recession and healthcare costs have come down because of the result of that.
It was also because of what was happening with things like health savings accounts and higher deductible plans, which is really where the movement toward insurance should be. If you want a strong social safety net, we should make sure that every American has a catastrophic care plan. You know, prevent that bankrupting. Matt, we agree with that. We want a strong social safety
net. There's no pre-existing conditions. There's all kinds of stuff you could have.
You know, 85% of Americans were satisfied with the health care they had. Now, might have been too expensive, but they liked the health care plan. You didn't have to destroy that system for 85% to provide care for the other people. It's madness. We're going to spend about $2.4 trillion on this health care law over the next 10 years.
But Senator, back to your plan. If you're saying that we can't repeal this, what you are proposing is actually a repeal of it. For you to say that you don't have to have the mandates on it. That is trying to say you want to repeal it.
Things like risk-sharing pools for small businesses, you know, these exchanges already exist. Well,
okay,
let's actually make them function, okay?
But call it what it is. What you are talking about is repealing Obamacare.
There's no mandate on corporations now. He's changed all kinds of the laws without repealing it.
I would call it limiting the damage, starting to dismantle the parts that simply aren't going to work, and start moving toward a free market-based solution.
But none of it is going to work if young people get to opt out.
Young people are going to opt out because they're either going to pay the penalty, which won't be collected, and we've already seen memos that they have no really method of collecting this thing. And when you already guarantee issue, when you can buy insurance regardless of pre-existing conditions, why buy it ahead of time? And so those are really the incentives in the
healthcare
law that is going to make it unworkable.
Your 27-year-old example, he won't buy health care.
No.
Is it a $100 penalty or something right now?
Yeah, but it's going to be 2.5% of their income in just 3 years, $695, and that'll get ramped up by inflation. So this isn't about choice. This isn't about freedom. This is about coercion. Now, this is the land of the free, home of the brave, or it used to be. And so, I just think Americans are going to take a look at this. They're going to see that it's a disaster. They are going to demand change. And I think the responsible thing for Republicans to do is do everything we can to limit the damage, try and preserve those plans that President Obama promised, you know, try and preserve the situation where people can actually keep their doctors, keep the treatment that kept them alive.
Do you have a solution that allows you to save those plans and also somehow insures the uninsured?
Yeah.
With catastrophic.
So you can do catastrophic care. You know, in Wisconsin, if you had a pre-existing condition and you were lasered out of, like, my health care plan
right.
that we provide our employees, you went to the high-risk pool. It worked. Every insurance policy was, you know, basically paid into that high-risk pool. There are about 22,000 Wisconsinites. It worked. When their condition, you know, was over, they would come back into your health care plan. It's a system that worked. And what you could do there is just say, listen, we will guarantee catastrophic care plan, and as long as you're insured, you go right into those high-risk pools, no pre-existing conditions. There's a way of doing this with 20-page bills, not 20,000 pages of bills. You didn't have to destroy the healthcare system we had. That wasn't perfect, but it was pretty darn good, and that's the problem.
Senator, thank you very much for joining us on set.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. When we come